Chris and Chris Talk Movies.
Hello, and welcome back to the podcast. My name is Chris Ferry, and of course, this is my co-host.
My name is Chris Huddleston.
Today, we are both very excited to be talking to you about the horror comedy, Innocent Blood.
That old black magic has me in its spell.
I could tell you're excited.
That old black magic that you weave so well. Those icy fingers up and down my spine.
Ah! Hey, what are you, some kind of a freak?
Now, this guy's lost a lot of blood.
You know, he had his head blown off.
No, this guy's really lost a lot of blood.
Marie had a hunger to feed on the evil.
You want a ride? You got one.
Michelli's a gangster.
Call me Sal.
Who's out to take over the city.
What do I call you?
Marie.
Wait, Marie.
What he didn't count on was a vampire.
Come on, baby. Relax.
With a taste for Italian. Now, the undead. And the undercover.
You are under arrest.
Are teaming up.
Michelli's not dead, is he?
Gotta get hold of yourself.
To take the bite out of crime.
You're gonna be made men. But when you're made by me, nobody can touch you. Welcome to the family.
From John Landis, the director of An American Werewolf in London.
You lost a lot of blood. Are you sure you don't need more?
Don't worry, you're not my type.
Innocent Blood, a movie that goes straight for the jugular. Under my skin.
Do you have a synopsis for us, Mr. Huddleston?
I do. Innocent Blood was a 1992 release directed by John Landis. It stars Anne Parillaud. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correct. It's a French name. Robert Loggia, Anthony LaPaglia, Don Rickles, Chaz Palminteri, and a bunch of other people. And the synopsis from Rotten Tomatoes is, Marie is a vampire with a conscience. She only sucks the blood of criminals. We'll have to talk about that. I don't know if they explicitly said that or not. And she has plenty to choose from on the mean streets of Pittsburgh, where a gang war is raging. It's not really a gang war, it's the mafia, but Marie slips up when she accidentally turns a violent criminal lord, Sal Michelli, Robert Loggia, into one of the Walking Dead. To stop a takeover of the city by blood-sucking gangsters, Marie joins forces with an undercover cop, Anthony LaPaglia, who has his own score to settle. So this one was new to each of us. I was aware of it, but I don't think you'd even heard of this, right?
Never even heard of it.
So what did you think?
There were parts of it that I liked quite a bit. I thought that Marie, the vampire lead, I felt that the camera loved her. She had a dazzling smile. There was a lot of the natural movie star to her. I did find, you know, English, she spoke heavily accented English, and to the degree that her delivery felt very stilted at times. And I that actually took me out of it a little bit, because I don't know that it equated to her not being a good actor. I just think, I don't know, maybe you can hear some of it in the trailer, but there would be times when she sort of talked like that. And I was sort of like, oh boy, I don't know. It just got in between me and connecting to the character. You know, and I think some of the performances of the goons were good too. I thought as a bad guy, you know, the mob boss was good. He was scary. And Don Rickles plays his lawyer. The comedy didn't really land most of the time for me. I never really found this film funny, but it was, clearly really trying to be funny, trying hard to be. And, you know, I think when the vampires attacked, some of that was genuinely scary slash startling slash effective, you know. They had kind of these corny
the contacts.
Contacts that, yeah, that they would either, you know, CGI in later with color, or maybe they had a colored light that would respond to it. But the color of the eyes was not consistent, and the contacts were frequently not seated properly, so the pupils were sometimes kind of looking off in different directions in a way that was unintentionally funny. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I feel like between this thing not really threading the needle of comedy and horror, which is tough. It's tough to do. But, you know, when it doesn't work, it doesn't work. So I just felt like it didn't really come together in a way that I, you know, that made it didn't click
mm-hmm.
for me. What about you?
Yeah, there's not much of that that I would disagree with. I mean, I sounds like we're going to be pretty, you know, similar in our views on this. So famously, John Landis directed, and I think wrote maybe as well, An American Werewolf in London, which is categorized as a horror comedy or comedy horror. To me, that film has always been a horror movie that has jokes in it. I've never really viewed, I mean, it's straight up horror in my opinion. You know, a horror comedy to me is something like Shaun of the Dead.
Right.
But Landis, he's had a mixed career. He directed, to me, you know, I've already mentioned American Werewolf in London, which is a classic, I think. And also The Blues Brothers, which is a classic too, which is, you know, just a comedy. But he directed the original Coming to America, and he directed Trading Places. So, you know, he has this comedy history. I would guess, who knows, but that they were trying to recapture some of what American Werewolf in London had.
Yeah.
And I don't think it was the humor. So it feels very disjointed. So there is, most of this movie is played fairly straight, I would say.
Yeah.
Especially a lot of the scenes with Anthony LaPaglia and her, those are all, none of that is humorous, really. But there, like, there's one scene where, Robert Loggia, you know, she turns him into a vampire, and then he just starts turning everybody else into vampires.
Right.
And I really like his performance, even though it's comedic. He just seems like he's having the time of his life in this role, you know?
Yeah. He's not holding anything back.
Yeah. He's really great, but it's not really, for the most part, slapstick. So it doesn't feel too out of place in this. But there are some scenes, like, for example, he turns, Don Rickles is his attorney, and he turns him into a vampire. And there's a scene where, so they take him to the hospital, and a nurse opens up the blinds, and he catches on fire. And it's a pretty neat effect, but you have all these nurses and doctors come running in, and they're screaming, and it seems like something in a sitcom or something. You know, it just feels very, it doesn't feel in tone with the rest of the film.
Right.
I enjoyed all of the performances. Basically, I thought Anthony LaPaglia and Chaz Palminteri and, you know, all these other people. And like I said, Robert Loggia is great. But as you said, you know, she's beautiful. And from a just physical acting standpoint, she does a good job. But exactly as you said, I really had a hard time getting past the line delivery with the accent.
Right.
And that's probably those two things, you know, her line delivery and the kind of weird tonal shifts are the biggest, weakest links in this to me.
Right.
I wonder if there was any kind of, you know, studio interference with this, that that, you know, maybe they wanted more jokes or whatever. I don't know. But it, you know, it's a movie that, you know, kind of 60-70% of the time seems pretty straight. And then there are just these really slapstick moments in it, you know.
You know, when it starts off, it's a shot of a cityscape, and I don't know if the whole movie is Sinatra or not, but there's a lot of Sinatra in the soundtrack. I just don't remember, but let's just say for the sake of argument that it's Sinatra. If not, it's one of the Italian crooners with a big orchestral, you know, and we sort of, and it's, you know, it's not That's Amore, but it made me think of Moonstruck. It made me think of that. This is an Italian American film about the romance of living in the city. You know, sure, we got a family. We're just watching out for each other, you know, and then there's a big sweeping score. Kind of like, okay. I know this movie. Okay. But it's got vampires in it. All right. I mean, I was interested at first, you know. It doesn't stick. It doesn't stay to that tone. When she first vampires out, one of the choices they make is they use a lot of like a wildcat sound or a lion. It's like, you know, and I'm like, is she making that noise? You know, because it's just wild. It's just like National Geographic. It's not modified in any way. Sometimes they do her voice a little bit where she sort of, they deepen it. And you're kind of like, no, I don't like that. That's a cheap sounding effect. But the, I mean, it's just the sound of a big cat, like a panther or something. And and they don't do anything to it. So I that took me out of a little bit, but you know, the, what he does with the camera and those eyes pop open. And when she first attacks, I guess it's Chaz Palminteri as her first victim. Right?
Yeah.
You know, he hits on her in kind of a ham-handed way, and but she's already got her sights set, so she gets in the car and he's got like, I don't know, 12 CDs or something in a case in the car, and they're all Sinatra CDs, and she just comments on it. She's like, nothing but Sinatra. And he's like, don't say anything, you know, not a word. You're like, that's supposed to be a joke. That moment is supposed to be a joke. Like, he literally has only Sinatra. It just feels weird. You know, you're kind of like, on the page, somebody wrote this, and then you all got together and you cast it and you shot it and you storyboarded it. And everyone was like, this will be funny. You know, I don't know. It's just not a funny joke. I like, could Jim Carrey make that funny? I don't know. It's just not funny. So it feels really strange because you're like, the scary stuff actually manages to be scary. And when the vampires turn, they have some fun with the mob boss. He doesn't know what's going on, right? I mean, nobody believes in vampires, so that's not your first thought. The comedy in it seemed so stilted and so forced that I was sort of scratching my head. Yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe the studio was like, this has to be, it'll be a summer, like a date night. It's got to be funny. It's got to be like, I think Sam Raimi's actually in this.
Yeah. We didn't even, so he puts, I'm glad you brought that up because I'd completely forgotten about that. He seemingly just puts a lot of his friends in there. Sam Raimi's in it. Frank Oz is in it. Dario Argento, the Italian director, he's a ambulance driver.
Yeah.
There's some other people in there. I can't believe I can't think of his name, but the effects guy, anyway, famous Pittsburgh effects guy is in it. I can't believe I can't think of his name.
It'll come. I don't know who you're talking about, but it'll come to you. But you know, Frank Oz, for those of you who don't know who Frank Oz is, he was a colleague and friend of Jim Henson's for a long time. Voice of Cookie Monster, voice of Bert, right? I mean, any of the Muppets on that original thing that were like Yin and Yang was Henson and Frank Oz, right? So he's funny. He's got great comic timing. He is a coroner in this and couldn't be playing it straighter.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I mean, there's lots of scenes where the one I'm thinking of right now is the coroner sort of backs away, not unable to believe what he's seeing. Like Frank Oz, if you had wanted Frank Oz to play that funny, Frank Oz could have played that funny. He clearly was directed not to in that moment. I'm just like, what? Maybe it was the kind of thing that he did one version of the movie and they didn't like it and they made him go back and reshoot a bunch of scenes. Who knows? It feels like that. It feels like, I don't know. It feels like they made a movie and then decided to change, you know, like 25-30% of it. And it just doesn't fit. She is extremely sexy, right? She's pretty comfortable. She spends a fair amount of the time on screen nude. She's lovely. And she has got a wonderful smile. Like I said before, a movie star smile. Like when she, regardless of the English as second language issue, when she smiles at the camera, you're like, that's a face. That woman was born to be on screen.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and yet, oddly, she doesn't seem to have any on-screen chemistry with any of the men that she either seduces and attacks or that is supposed to be her love interest, right? So there's an undercover cop who is a member of the family. And then is it Angela Bassett is his?
Yeah. I forget. They didn't even mention Angela Bassett in the as the main credits. Well, this had to have been a pretty early role for her.
Yeah. Has a couple of like strained little scenes where she's basically, you know, like, we're pulling you out of there. And he's like, you can't pull me out now. Like, I'm so close. She's too dangerous, you know?
Yeah.
And so
this is chock full of people, you know?
Yeah. And this guy is hell bent on getting, you know, it's the Departed or whatever. This undercover cop is hell bent on bringing down the big boss. And he's this close. So all of this vampire stuff kind of throws a curveball in it. And it's clear on the page he is supposed to. She is seductive, right? She is. There's a comic scene where she's like, you know, there's these two sort of cops that are doing what Angela Bass is like, stay on him, you know, make sure he gets out. So there's these two kind of, you know, Pete and Repeat who are sort of chasing him around. And there's a scene in which she's twirling them around her finger and getting their heads all kooky, and that's supposed to be played for laughs, but for the most part you get it. She doesn't have any trouble talking her way into one of these guys' cars, and they're all just kind of gaga over here. And it's clear that this undercover agent is also supposed to fall for her. He's onto her, right? He understands that something supernatural is going on here. He sees her with blood all over her face and the mob boss's dead body in the tub. So he knows that she killed him by tearing his throat out with her teeth. Whether or not he can bring himself to believe that she's a vampire or not, that's makes an impression, right? So he knows that she's dangerous and a murderess and there's something else going on here. But he clearly can't help. They sort of team up to go get this guy because she's now. So one thing we didn't say is she only apparently eats bad people and then she takes a shotgun and blows their head off before they can turn. So she's doesn't want to eat, drink innocent blood, which is, I guess, where the title comes from. And she doesn't want to leave a trail of vampires in her wake. We don't know more than that. We don't get more of her backstory. None of this is why. None of that's ever answered. But he doesn't know that he's safe from her, but that's supposed to be part of it. Like, it's pretty well built as a kind of a romantic comedy in that way, but you don't feel any of this on screen. Like, there is stuff where he's saying he's sort of playing like he's scared of her, and there's stuff where he's playing like he's sort of angry at her, like, I know you were a murderer, you're a criminal, I need to take you in. But what we never see is him making eyes at her despite himself, and I would think that's the one obvious scene. Like, for those of you watching, there's this sort of scene behind me where they're sitting on the couch, you know, and she is more or less naked wearing one of his coats for blah, blah, blah movie reasons. And he's injured and she sort of taped him up and he's sitting there on the couch and it's supposed to be awkward because she's like, I like you. I want to be, you know, your temporary girlfriend because I'm a woman and I have needs. It's the only thing that makes my, she has a monologue in the beginning. That's the only thing that makes my existence worth living is sex, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Hard finding the right partner. So she's decided this is the right partner and I'm not going to eat him because he's a good guy. And she doesn't explain any of this to him. He knows she's a killer and maybe a vampire, so that's terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, this scene could have been the anchor of the movie, and it just is a big nothing burger. I thought, like, I even went back and rewatched this scene, and I just couldn't figure out what was going through their head directly. Yeah. I was like, what is happening?
Yeah, yeah. Tom Savini is who I was trying to think of. He's the photographer. He's the photographer guy, but he's
in the car. He's the guy
in the car. Yeah. He's from, he lives in Pittsburgh now, but I think he's lived in Pittsburgh his whole life. But so he's another basically cameo that he put in the movie. But yeah, and this gets into what the movie was versus kind of what I would want it to be. But I think a better film, you know, it starts out with her, you know, killing Chaz Palminteri, and then she tries to kill Robert Loggia. I don't remember if she kills anybody else in between or not, but you know, it goes from her going around killing these guys, which I think, you know, so much of the time with mob movies, you know, people get kind of the wrong message from them where they look at these people as heroic figures,
right?
And this, at least early on, kind of turns it on its head because it's like, here's this vampire going around killing these scumbag guys, you know. And you have that for a little while, and then once Robert Loggia is turned, then it just becomes the two of them trying to stop him. You know, which I think a more interesting, maybe a more simple story, but I think a more interesting story is him meeting her and falling for her and her continuing to kill these mob guys.
Yeah.
You know, and him being like, well, I love her and she's killing these bad guys, but also I'm a cop and what she's doing is wrong, you know, and then he's got to kill her at the end or whatever, you know, and none of that happens.
Yeah, in a woulda, coulda, shoulda world. I mean, that's one of the things that I loved so much about Let the Right One In is, yes, it's a different vision of a vampire as a 12-year-old, but the relationship with the sort of male familiar that at first is sibling or friend, and then as the human ages is a more like an uncle or a father figure, right, over time, because the vampire doesn't age, but the person that she latches on to, she, he, they latch on to, does. And I thought, oh, that's, and why does this person stay? Like, what is the hold that a vampire has over a human being? You know, and in the traditional sense, it's seduction, but I love the peeling that onion of like, well, what to what depth does that go? Is it simply a romantic or a sexual seduction? Because that movie was sort of like, no, these two people that we see in the course of the movie, the first one that dies early and then the one with whom that person is replaced, seem to form a bond with the vampire that is almost existential. You know, and I had never really seen that on screen before. I thought that was super cool. I love playing with the moral ambiguity of it and your idea of, you know, keeping it with the mafia, which after The Sopranos is complicated because, you know, you root for Tony Soprano and his family, but they're monsters, you know, and the movie doesn't let you forget, or the series doesn't let you forget that. It keeps reminding you that they are almost psychopathic killers, really, only interested in themselves.
And you have a couple of Sopranos actors in
many, this. Actually. Yeah. Yes. You're kind of like, where's Tony? You look around, you're like, the only one missing for this picture is Gandolfini. But yeah, I mean, I think that would have been a better movie.
Yeah.
I kind of, when I sat down and we started rolling and I heard the soundtrack and everything, I was like, I wanted to like it.
Mm-hmm.
But I just ended up feeling like it didn't really ever come together. It didn't sort of deliver. And I keep harping on this, but I didn't find myself particularly caring about any of the characters. Even her, who I've gone on about now, but even her who I think is instantly charming. You know, once she smiles, you're kind of like, well, all right, I like her. But yeah. I never found myself caring. You're like, she's not going to die. You know, this movie is not one in where this vampire is going to get staked.
Mm-hmm.
It's never even, you know, never crosses your mind that anything terminal could happen to that character.
And spoiler alert, you know, they wind up killing Robert Loggia in the end, and it's just like they're going to live happily ever after, this cop and this vampire, I guess. Yeah. Not to be too critical of her, because like you've said, you know, she's beautiful and very charming and all that, but I wonder why she was cast in this film.
Yeah.
You know, there's not any reason that this character has to be French. You know, and they don't explain any of that. I mean, I suppose that, you know, if you want to read something into it, it could be like, well, you know, she has to go from place to place, you know, to stay ahead of getting caught or whatever. But were you familiar at all with her? Had you ever seen her in anything else?
Not that she does look vaguely familiar in some way, but I couldn't place what other films I would have seen her in.
So I looked her up, and she is in the original La Femme Nikita, which I'd never seen. And that's one that we should do on the show. I would be interested in watching that. But with that being a French film, presumably when she's speaking her native language, I would think that the line delivery is probably better.
Yeah. She's the kid. She's the Natalie Portman role from the remake. Is that correct?
So that is the professional remake of La Femme Nikita.
I think so. Maybe I'm wrong about that.
She's an adult, and because it was made like shortly before this. So
just a reminder to our listeners, we are not film professionals.
Yeah, I think they did an actual. So there was an actual. It's not like I know the history of La Femme Nikita, but there was an American remake, and then there was a show. Like in the mid 90s, that I never really watched either. But anyway, that's one that we ought to do. It gets a pretty high rating, and you know, it might be interesting. But I just wonder what the reasoning was for her being cast in this.
Yeah.
Because there isn't any reason that this couldn't have been an American actor or a British actor or something, you know.
No, and if you want to be a nerd about it, which I can't help being, this vampire depicted in this film, you get the sense that this vampire has been operating in this way for a while. Like, mm-hmm. not a new vampire. This is an old vampire.
Yeah.
Whether that's 100 years or 500 years or 1,000 years, maybe not 1,000. And to me, you know, you got nothing but time on your hands. You've never learned to speak English better than this. Why are you operating in Pittsburgh?
Like, yeah.
There, you know, none of these choices ever come anywhere into the film, and they're one of my favorite things about, like, so a vampire movie. I remember watching True Blood, and there's a character that was one of the oldest vampires. Like, he kept saying, like, I'm almost 3,000 years old, and he would talk about pre-Roman times, and you know, and mm-hmm. think, what a juicy performance where that's introduced into, what a juicy role to play when that's introduced into it. The choices you can make. I mean, you'd go, and he is insane, but you would go insane living that long.
Yeah.
And exploring the ways in which that would affect your mind.
I always think about with vampire movies, the thought of living forever. I always think about how exhausting it would be to have to try to figure out how to make a living all that time. You know what I mean? It's just like, oh, now, like, I, you know, I got to learn to do this thing now. And, you know, a couple of little tidbits with this, and just a little bit of reading that I did about it. it initially had an NC-17 rating. It didn't say if that was for, I mean, there's a lot, she's naked a lot in this, you know, as you said. So I don't know if it was explicit sex or if it was violence, but they had to cut 2 or 3 minutes out to get an R rating.
Might have been a bit of both. There's a pretty intimate sex scene. It's not graphic, but it's affecting. It's mostly her. I mean,
she handcuffs herself, and you know.
Yeah, yeah, and you think this feels like a French movie. Like this, this is, you know, the pan is so hot here, it's starting to smoke.
That's another one of those weird tonal things, you know?
Yeah. If the movie had, you know, if you're going to cast this actor, you have to let that affect, the whole movie needs to be the crown in which that jewel is set. The whole movie needs to support that. Whether you decide to go counter it, where it's like in this world of like, Clams Casino and that we bring this element into that, and the whole thing is how that resonates and chimes. But I think to make it effective, it just felt really arbitrary, and I'm like, why would you put this ingredient in that dish? Because it just, you know, and it can be surprising, and you, to carry on a culinary metaphor, that can be surprising sometimes when you're like, wow, I never would have imagined pineapple on pizza, but it's really good. You know what I mean? That's the kind of thing you're going for when you say, well, we've got the French vampire and we got the Italian mob, but it didn't feel like there was really it'll work. No, it won't. You can't just let it be. You have to craft it in such a way that it works in surprising ways. And I didn't see any effort toward that.
Yeah, I don't think you can do violent and scary and sexy and funny all in the same movie.
Yeah,
you know?
I'm not saying it can't be done, but it's pretty high bar.
Yeah. And I think something like, you know, an American Werewolf in London, where, like I was saying, you know, I kind of think as a serious movie that has jokes in it.
Yeah.
That's kind of how real life is. You know, you're not 100% serious all day or all week or whatever, you know. Serious things can happen, you know. People go to a funeral and they're crying 1 minute and they're laughing, you know, the next minute. So I think you can put, you know, you can have a very serious film and put jokes in it, or not even necessarily jokes, but people saying humorous things,
right?
But just the slapstick stuff is what really got to me, you know?
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. Comedy is a part, it's how we navigate our life, and it is one of the mechanisms we use to cope with how painful and disappointing and tragic life can be. I saw a production of King Lear at Lincoln Center 10, 12, I don't know, years ago, with Christopher Plummer playing Lear. And what struck me the most, like, for those of you who don't know King Lear, it's long and it is absolutely harrowing. This production was the best Lear I've ever seen, because the director and the cast found every opportunity for comedy they could. And there ain't a ton of it in Lear, but they found every possible opportunity for comedy and they really nailed it. And that, I thought that's how you do Lear. Like, that's the only way Lear is bearable, because it's such a body blow of tragedy after body blow after body blow, the whole thing. And it's like 4 hours long.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that having something that is scary and or you know, drama, tragic, and funny, it's the most natural thing in the world, because humor is what we go to deal with the horror of this stuff. And I think they did it in the 80s, those slasher films, it was sort of baked right into it, and it didn't feel, I mean, that's a whole separate tone they were going for, but it doesn't feel jarring. Camp and horror doesn't feel jarring, because in some ways they feel like but two different sides of the same coin.
Mm-hmm.
And here it just felt sort of like what is this? A slapstick, like you said, is like this is a Three Stooges. What Marx Brothers? What are we going for here? You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, casting Don Rickles. Don Rickles is in it. I can't think of too many other actual, you know, film performances I've seen Don Rickles in.
And he's not bad in it, you know. I mean,
but he's also not the funny lawyer. Like, it's a straight role for Don Rickles. And you're like, you got to let this guy off the leash. You got to give him something, right?
Yeah.
And this guy is directed, I mean, what you said, 48 Hours, right? Did he do Coming to America?
He did Coming to America. He didn't do 48 Hours, I don't think. He did Trading Places.
Okay, Trading Places, funny movie, right? Yeah. Coming to America, really funny movie. So it's not that, I mean, those were probably later than this.
And the Blues Brothers.
Yeah, I didn't think the Blues Brothers is a classic. I don't really find it all that funny. but you know, I guess at least later you're able, and you know, working with Eddie Murphy, you just got to get out of his way. But Don Rickles, not like he's doesn't know what he's doing with a joke. Maybe he learned later in his directing career, you got to cast the right people and then you have to let them do their thing instead of being.
Well, and here's the thing with Landis at this point is in his career. I don't know how familiar you are with any of that, but he was, have you ever seen Twilight Zone, the movie?
Yes.
Like, okay. So, you know, that's an anthology and they had different directors for each story. And one of the ones that he directed is, this guy who is a racist and he gets kind of magically in a Twilight Zone way sent back to like the Civil War, and he's this white racist guy and he gets sent back to the Civil War and everybody sees him as black. And there's another part where he gets sent to Vietnam during the Vietnam War and everybody sees him as as a Vietnamese person. And when they were working on the film, the actor who plays the racist guy, there's a scene where it's the Vietnam scene and there's a helicopter flying overhead and it's him and two Vietnamese children that he's running with. And when they were filming that, Landis wanted the helicopter to be really low and he was screaming, you know, lower, lower. And the helicopter crashed and it killed that guy, that actor, and those two children. It decapitated them, the blades of the helicopter. And so that caused a lot of damage to his career because he was actually tried for, negligent homicide. He wasn't convicted, but Steven Spielberg was a producer of that movie and directed one of the segments and they were good friends. And after that, Spielberg kind of, distanced himself from him. And so at this point in his career, I think he was kind of struggling to get stuff made. You wonder how, like I say, you wonder how much the studio interfered or the budget was only 20 million.
Yeah.
Which even for 1992 isn't a lot, or wasn't a lot. And it only made like 5 million. So it was a big flop.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a really great director.
Horrible story.
Yeah, yeah. I don't mean to be a downer, but yeah.
But think about what, I mean, the tragic loss of life speaks for itself, but having something like that happen during the shooting of a movie, I don't know how, I mean, it's a big collaborative artistic project.
Mm-hmm.
It's fraught with all kinds of hardship, financial, location, there's a lot of people involved, their relationships get in the way. It's hard to make a movie full stop.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to make a good movie. And having something like that, it seems like that would just utterly destroy the project. I just can't even imagine finishing.
Yeah. I mean, they still, obviously the film was still released and I don't know how much controversy there was about that at the time. I think it was quite a bit after the release that he went to trial. And like I say, he wasn't convicted, But it definitely hurt his career because, you know, there were people that viewed him as a, you know, as a bad guy after this.
Yeah, reckless, if nothing else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, he also famously directed the Michael Jackson Thriller video as well, which, you know, was a is a giant cultural, you know, thing for anybody who lived in the 80s.
I used to get sick of it because they played it on such heavy rotation on MTV and it was 15 minutes. So it's not like you just sit through this one for the next one. Like, that's the beginning of short attention span, kids.
Yeah.
MTV, when I'm like, oh my God, the 15 minute Michael Jackson one again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was a big deal.
So right, what do you think as far as final rating recommendation and that kind of stuff?
I will probably not recommend it, just using the entertaining litmus test. I mean, if you've enjoyed our conversation and you think, huh, that sounds crazy, I want to check it out. It was like $2.99 on Amazon Prime.
And we didn't spoil too much except the ending. I spoiled the ending. We didn't get too much into the plot.
Guess what? They win. I mean, there's nothing in this movie that sets up this sort of like, man, maybe this is one of those ones where the good guy gets it in the end. No, it's not that movie. And it's immediately obvious from the beginning. So we didn't really spoil anything. But, I, you know, if I just say, you know, is it good to sit down with a bowl of popcorn and watch this on your own? I'd be kind of not really. It's like, is it good for a date to do the same? See above? Not really. So kind of like, I guess thumbs down for me.
I liked it a little more. I mean, I would say it's kind of a mild recommend. This is, I mean, you know, there's nothing terrible about it. And, you know, you watching this, I mean, you can see that, you know, he was a talented or is a talented director. You know, it's shot well and it looks good. And overall, I think pretty much all the performances are good except, you know, her line delivery. And I mostly had fun with it. It's just the, like we talked about a lot, just the that it's kind of all over the place with the tone. But,
yeah,
you know, if you like horror comedy, I mean, there aren't a ton of these movies that are necessarily great. And also I like going back and watching movies from the time frame when we grew up, because this would have just been like the beginning of college for us.
Yeah.
I like to watch movies from that era that I've not seen before. So, you know, I think it's kind of fun to just see what things look like, you know, and sort of have some of that nostalgia from that period. But I mean, this movie's kind of about a 6 out of 10, I think. There was enough about it that I enjoyed that I was entertained overall, but it's not a great movie by any stretch of the imagination.
Fair enough. Chris and Chris talk movies at gmail.com. That is our handle. We are on the socials. You might be listening to us on one of your favorite podcast applications, or you might be watching/listening to us on our YouTube channel. Either way, if you like and subscribe, leave a comment, engage. Those are all good things in the digital world for us, and we love to hear from you.
Yeah, let us know how we're doing. And if you have suggestions for things for us to watch, we're always open for that.
Sure.
But do that.
Next time, we're going to be talking about In the Mouth of Madness, which is John Carpenter. Mm-hmm. John Carpenter, one of the lesser known ones, I felt. That should be interesting. It's got, me and my names. Who's
Sam Neill.
Sam Neill stars in that. And if you feel like it, check that out, and we can talk about that together next time. And unless you have anything else to add, Monsieur?
No, I think that's it.
We will talk to you all next week. Bye.